Hey everybody, and welcome again to Fatty Aquarium channel. And today we will talk about different kinds of rock, the nitrogen cycle, and how to aquascape the tank. Live rock is the main biological filtration in the reef tank. What makes the rocks alive are the many forms of micro and microscopic marine life that lives on and inside the rock. The rock itself is only made up of calcium carbonate skeletons of all dead corals. We use live rock to enhance the look of the aquarium, habitat for fish and other animals, placing corals and, most important, filtering the tank. The use of live rock will introduce numerous algae, bacteria and small invertebrates to the aquarium that will contribute in the overall quality of the aquarium water. What is the nitrogen cycle? In the aquarium, the waste produced by fish, leftover food and dead organic matter will break down into ammonia. Ammonia is highly toxic to fish and corals, and ammonia spike can kill all tank inhabitants. The next step in the process, where bacteria absorb ammonia from the aquarium water and converts it into nitrite. While not as toxic as ammonia, nitrite can be harmful for the aquarium inhabitants. Another type of bacteria will convert nitrite into nitrate, which is the final product of the nitrogen cycle. Compared to ammonia and nitrite, it's much less toxic. However, there should be a way to remove nitrate before it builds up to a dangerous level in the aquarium water. The main way to export nitrate is by regular water change. Regular weekly water change will help to keep the nitrate level in check. Anaerobic bacteria that is found in your aquarium live rock and areas with lower oxygen levels, like deep sand pit, can consume nitrate and release it as nitrogen gases into the atmosphere. This is why you may see what appears like air bubbles inside the sand. The refugium is also a great way to export nutrients like nitrate and phosphate. Algae will consume the nitrate in the water as it grows, and you just need to remove any excess algae. Similar to refugium, there are algae reactors and algae scrubbers. Wet rocks comes directly from the ocean, with the majority of the living organisms, bacteria, algae and many other invertebrates and critters. The main advantage of wet rock is it's very helpful in quickly cycling the tank. This rocks will come covered in coralline algae, so it will look better and more established and will reduce the time to cycle the tank. The main disadvantages of live rock that it can come with some unwanted hitchhikers like mantis shrimp, bristle worms, aptasia, flatworms, and other unwanted pests and algae. Many hobbyists restarted their tanks because of these pests. The advantages of dry rock, that this rock comes completely dead and dry, no living organisms in it. For that, it will take more time to complete the cycle and for the rock to be covered with coralline algae. Artificial man-made rocks are getting more popular. These rocks can be made from aragonite, ceramic or dry rocks. These rocks are coated and colored to simulate real coralline algae, so you don't have to wait 6 to 8 months for coralline algae to grow to have a mature looking tank. In addition, some brands infuse live bacteria into these rocks. One thing to look for in live rock is the surface area and porosity. The more surface area, the more places available for nitrifying bacteria to live and thrive. Both wet and dry rocks need curing before adding to the aquarium. A curing wet rock will get rid of the dying organisms and reduce the chances of introducing pests to the tank. First, rinse the rock with some salt water in a bucket to remove any dead or dying algae. If the rocks have some patches of rotten or dead organic material, you can use a brush to scrub the rock clean. Please note that there will be a lot of spraying when brushing the rock, so I recommend to use some safety glasses like this. Also, I recommend wearing gloves like this when handling the rock. Some people may have allergies to the rock or the organisms living on the rock, so I always recommend to wear the protective gear. And remember, never to boil the live rock. There were some reports about polyotoxin poisoning after boiling the rocks that contains zoanthid and pleothor. Then put the rocks back in a bucket with clean salt water with a heater and power head to let any unwanted dead and decaying organisms to break down. Keep inspecting the rock for any unwanted hitchhikers and remove them This will take from few weeks up to 3 months, depending on the quality and the freshness of the live rock. You can also do the curing process in the aquarium instead, but you will need to do a 100% water change after the curing is done. It's not recommended to use light during the curing process, as it will promote unwanted algae growth. For dry rock, you need to inspect the rock thoroughly and remove any dry algae, sponges, and any other organic matter. All these dead organics will start to break down in water and add high concentration of phosphate and nitrate in addition to other yellow coloring pigments. You can also brush the rocks regularly while in curing. Bleach soaking the rock can be helpful in cleaning dry rocks. Bleach will oxidize and break down organics like algae and sponges. To bleach bath a rock, you need 1 to 10 ratio bleach to fresh water. Bleach can be dangerous, so please take all the needed precautions and wear eye protection and gloves and try to soak the rocks in a well-ventilated area or outside the house. Keep the rock soaking for 1 week in bleach solution. Then brush it and wash it with clean fresh water. To get rid of any traces of bleach, you can keep the rock completely dry outside in a sunny and dry location, or just soak it in fresh water with some dechlorine for a day. It's important to know that curing live rock will create a stinky and bad odor as the organic die off and break down. You can add a bag of carbon to reduce this odor. Also, using bleach on dry rock will minimize this odor. Remember, don't use bleach on live rock as it will kill it. If you are using artificial rock, minimal cleaning is needed. You can just rinse the rock with water and start using it directly. After the curing is done, it's time to aquascape the tank. In my tank, I use a mix of cured live rock and dead dry rock. In Hani's tank, we are using 100% dry rock. It's recommended to use 1 to 2 pounds of rock per gallon. If you are going with minimalist aquascape that use much less amount of rock, I suggest to add the extra amount of rock in high flow area in the sun. Aquascaping a reef tank is the way of arranging live or dry rocks in an attractive and pleasing way within an aquarium. And it is the most important thing to build an attractive and beautiful reef tank. So you need to spend some time and effort into this. I recommend looking for examples on how to build the aquascape, a good thread on Reef to Reef named Tips and Tricks on Creating Amazing Aquascape is very helpful for ideas that can be helpful for creating your own aquascape. You can find the link in the description below. The most important rule in aquascaping the tank is the rule of thirds. The rule of thirds is a technique for making art more interesting and dynamic. And you can apply it to your reef aquarium to make it a living piece of art. Your goal here is not to center your main structures. You split the tank with 2 vertical and another 2 horizontal lines to split the views into thirds. Look at the 4 points where the lines interact. Your goal is to hit these points. You want the overall look to be off center, to throw the viewer's eye all over the tank instead of just in the middle. To apply this on your aquarium, use some tape to make these lines. In addition, you need to give the rock structure the feeling of depth, where some rocks can be a little higher or lower. You can search this thread to similar sized tanks and inspire from their aquascape. Also, you need to try to avoid the pile of rock lock and focus on creating caves and empty spaces so the fish have good swimming room and hiding places to escape aggression. Caves and arcs can be created by stacking the rock and attach them using epoxy or glue. Another cool thing to do in a reef tank, especially if you are adding some SBS corals, is to have some shelf rocks. Shelf rock is a piece of flat rock that can be used to arrange SPS frag easily over them. Try not to stack the rocks over the second third of the tank. This is to keep a good space for corals to grow and fish to swim. Keep in mind that aquascaping and gluing the rocks is a lot easier dry rather than in a water-filled tank. We will empty the water in the tank in some containers and we will do aquascape, and after that we will fill it again with the same water. For attaching the rock together, we can use 2-part epoxy. two-part epoxy comes in two parts, and we mix them together, then we glue the rock. There is also plastic epoxy, which is a new alternative for two parts epoxy. The plastic pellets melt using hot water and can be reused over and over again. When melted, the pellets fuse together and become transparent and soft. When it cools, it becomes hard yet flexible. Now, after that, our aquascape is done, we can add the sand. Most reefers use sand for its looks, or if keeping a fish that requires sand to thrive, like sand sifting guppies. Keep in mind that many reefers are going with bare bottom tanks, so it's a personal choice to go bare bottom or to go with sand. There are many sizes of sand. The finer ones are suitable for sand sifting guppies, while a strong current in the tank can create sandstorm inside the tank. Sand with grain size averages between 1 to 2 millimeters are good options for keeping sand sifting guppies, and the sand will not be blown away easily as with finer sand. Try not to mix different sizes together, as with time, these will spread. Like rocks, sand can be dry or can be live. Live sand comes wet or damp and packaged with beneficial bacteria. Both of them will work, and I'll use high quality aragonite sand and what is available locally. Some of the popular brands are Carib Sea and Red Sea. If you are using dry sand, you need to wash it clean until all the dust is washed away and the washing water runs clean. For live sand, there is no need to wash the sand, as washing the sand will wash away all the bacteria. Thin layers of sand is easier to maintain and clean, so I think 1 inch is the sweet spot for maintaining and keeping an attractive look to the tank. In addition, this is a good thickness for sand sifting guppies. To calculate how much sand you need to fill your tank, you can use sand calculator on my website, fadiaqua.com, as well as other helpful reef tank related calculators. Make sure to add the sand after the rock, as the rock should sit directly on the glass. Doing so will make the rock structure more stable. After adding the sand, we will fill the tank with salt water and wait for a day or two until it clears. When we talk about having a cycled and established tank, we are referring to having a tank with developed and functioning nitrogen cycle within our aquarium. The live rock is filled with nitrifying bacteria. Buying enough live rock for your tank will likely provide enough bacteria to get the cycle process started in your tank. However, if we are using dry rock or we want to speed up the process, we need to introduce an ammonia source like fish food, raw shrimp, or pure ammonia, in addition to start a bacteria product to kickstart the cycle. I like to use Brightwell Aquatics Microbacter 7 or MP7. I use it to cycle this tank and my QT tank and any new tank also. And I usually dose MP7 after a new fish addition to the tank to avoid mini cycles. I don't prefer to start the cycle with live fish, as most probably it will die. It's harsh on the fish and not human. When I started cycling this tank, I started to dose pure ammonia and MP7. I was adding the recommended amount of MP7 for 2 weeks and dosing ammonia on day 1, 3, and 6. I was testing ammonia, nitrate, and nitrate daily until my ammonia and nitrate became zero. I started to add fish. My first fish was this blue hippo tank. I also added this ammonia alert. It's very helpful to have a constant monitoring for ammonia. After this, I started weekly 10% water change. In Handy's tank, we are dosing MP7 per direction. We are dosing 25 ml of MP7 daily for 2 weeks. Currently, we are not running a skimmer, but if you have a skimmer, you need to shut it down for 4 hours while dosing MP7. That's it for today. Thanks for watching. Next week, we will speak about flow and wave makers. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and see you soon in my next video.